Done wrong. We'll get back together now.
Back in session.
Okay, I wanted to wrap up supervised learning really quickly. Since you're Java developers, I wanted to show you some actual Java code. This is using deep learning for J libraries. And to create this neural network in Java code, it uses a kind of a fluent library where you can give it, remember I told you about random numbers being seeded in the weights and biases. This is a seed for the random number generator. This is iterations. How many iterations do you want to go through the data set? By the way, one iteration through the data set is called an epoch. And then what activation function do you want to be default? By the way, I had a nice question from Roman. Can you mix and match activation functions? And yes, you can. You can have each layer can have a unique set of activation functions. You can't mix and match them within a layer, but you can have different ones in different layers if you'd like. So the default here is hyperbolic tangent. And then we've got something called a learning rate. Learning rate is where, remember when you're stepping down the gradient, you know, you're finding out, hey, I'm going the right direction, going the right direction. Now, the learning rate is how big a step you take. And so you can have a problem at the bottom, for example, and maybe you're taking too big a steps, and then you end up overstepping, and then you can actually end up like this, to where you're never getting to the bottom, and you're kind of skipping over the bottom. And so when you see that happening, your error will, you'll see it go down, and you'll see it go up and down and up and down. What's happening is it's skipping back and forth across the bottom of that gradient. And so you just back off your learning rate. It's a trade-off, though. The lower the learning rate, the more iterations it takes, because the more steps you're taking. Then you have different layers. So here's the first hidden layer, and how many inputs you have from the input layer, how many outputs you have to the next layer. Same thing with this layer. And this happens to be the output layer. We're going to use a softmax because we want the probabilities to add up to 1. And do a back propy up and build. And so that's some typical Java code. If you were using TensorFlow or literally any other, or practically any other learning library, machine learning library, you're going to be using Python. And so you've got a choice. But you could, you know, like with TensorFlow, you can use Java, but it's always a step behind because their main language that they're using that they're developing TensorFlow with is for Python API. And of course, this application they developed is Java Spring. And so if you want to develop a Spring application, just go to start.spring.io. You tell it what kind of things you want in your application. It'll download a POM for you and some starter code, and it makes it really easy. It manages all your transitive dependencies, so you don't go through, you know, jar hell like you can in Java. This slide is a lab exercise. When I give this as a workshop, then it's a really nice lab exercise that gives you some hands-on for being able to tune a neural network, train and tune a neural network. I'd like to get rid of this thing. Okay. And so it's called a neural network playground. And so you can change, like the number of layers, the number of neurons in your different layers, change your activation functions, change your learning rate, and then see how it impacts your training. So here's your output, your test loss and your training loss. Here we're getting very slowly down to, 0.3, 0.2, 0.1. Yeah, we're getting pretty low. We're doing that in, 67 iterations. I've gotten down to 0.22. But maybe if I increase my learning rate, maybe to 0.1, and let's see, let's start that over, and let's see, do we get down more quickly? Yeah, it's going down more quickly. And so, but changing other hyperparameters, right, could help you tune your neural network. And again, it's a kind of a dark art. Here's a paper on, is your optimizing your neural network a dark art? And so there's some suggestions for doing that. A guy by the name of V.V. Preetham has written a pretty good Medium article on it. So what I've shown you now is a fully connected neural network. So there are other types of neural networks that typically then use a fully connected network as part of it, but then also use other topologies. So one of those topologies at the break, I was asked about image processing. And the gentleman is creating has a game and is trying to recognize images in the game. So how would you do that? Well, one way is to use a convolutional neural network. So here's a link to a site. It's actually the opening page of a Stanford course. And on that, they've got implemented the serving part, the feed forward part of a convolutional neural network that takes an image and then recognizes what's in the image, some correctly, some incorrectly. But and then here we have different layers in the convolutional network on what the network sees. So how it's kind of reduced the features down into something it can then use to recognize at the end. So what I'd like to do is now kind of dive into that. Here's the architecture for a typical convolutional neural network. So you've got some input here. Let's say that's a small picture. Let's say it's a 200 by 200 picture. Well, that's 40,000 features. Each feature is a pixel. But wait, if it's RGB, now you've got 12,000 features, each with a value of 0 to 255. So you've got this huge input. So I guess you could use a huge, fully connected network with the input layer of for whatever I said it was. I guess 120,000 inputs. Or you could use something that Jan LeCun, who's the kind of CIO or the chief learning officer, or chief machine learning person or whatever at Facebook, and a pioneer in convolutional neural networks. You could use something that he and colleagues have come up with called convolutional neural networks, which has as its as first several layers a combination of a convolutional layer and a pooling layer. Convolutional layer is one in which you take the input and then you do like a Photoshop convolution where it's kind of like a Photoshop filter, where you're doing some edge detection or you're doing some blurring or whatever. And then you have several then copies of that are looking for different things. And then you have a pooling layer, a downsampling layer, where you might take 4 pixels and average them into a lower resolution picture. And then you do that iteratively. You have, you know, multiple sets of pairs of those layers, and then finally you get to a fully connected network at the end, which presumably would have some type of a softmax layer that then does your classification and tells you what kind of thing this is. So there's a really nice site that this gentleman by the name of Adam Harley created that then is this convolutional network in your browser kind of playground, I guess. So there's this another data set called MNIST. And what MNIST is it's handwritten digits. And it was created for the United States Postal Service so they could recognize zip codes without having to, a human having to read them all. And so this particular model uses MNIST, was trained with MNIST, And so there's a link here, and it's right here. So let's say that I wanted to draw the number 8. So we can see the layers of the network. Here's the original input. Here's the first convolutional layer. And notice that there's different types of convolutions or filtering that's happening that's looking for different kinds of things like edges or blurring or whatever. And so it's doing filtering. Here, it's downsampling, doing pixel averaging. Here's another convolutional layer. And we see the, you know, see where the pixels are that it's coming from. And then here's downsampling. And then this layer is the first fully connected layer, which again is doing some doing some type of, let's see, there's more. I don't know whether that's a downsample or not. I'm gonna assume it's a downsample. And then here we have the last layer. This last layer, for historic reasons, is typically called the FC7 layer. And because it's, it, I guess in the original implementation, it was the 7th layer. And in this particular case, in this implementation, there are 100 values here. So it's 100 dimensional vector with 100 different real numbers. And so that this number 8 that I drew is then reduced to this 100 dimensional vector. And then here, then we have these connected to that and making the, you know, with the output layer, and then saying that, yeah, there's a high probability that it's an 8. There's less of a probability that it's a 6. And so that's kind of visually how a convolutional network works. Now, I want you to keep this FC7 layer in mind. It's not always a 100-dimensional vector. It could be 200-dimensional vector, 300, you know, whatever. But it's kind of a code. It encodes what was in the original image or whatever the source was. So it's this compact, then, you know, finite number of dimension vector that can be used to represent that image. Okay. So anyway, just kind of hold that thought in a little bit, because it'll be relevant in a little bit when we get into unsupervised learning. So there's fully connected networks. There was convolutional neural networks, which is good for images. There's another thing that's good for time series data. So all of the examples that I've shown you so far, where we take this iris, or we take this this image that we've created, or this image that we're looking at, or this XOR state, that's all static. It's all one-time data. But many times you're working with time series data. Time series data could be words in a document, you know, because the sequence of the words is important. Or it could be the frames in a movie. Like, for example, in this case, here's a couple of cats which look strangely, they're not my cats, but they look strangely like the two cats I have at home. And these are playing in a box. And if you showed a computer this, how could the computer know what was going to happen next, right? Now you know what's going to happen next, right? What's going to happen next? It's going to go like that, right? Because you know about cats, and you know about gravity, right? And so obviously the heavier cat, or the cat that's on top, is going to push the other one down. And so you are right. That's exactly what happens. I spent like 3 or 4 hours on Giphy trying to find the perfect GIF for you guys, for you all. And well, I mean, like every day, I usually spend 3 or 4 hours on Giphy. So that's a job for recurrent neural networks, because it's time series data, being able to predict, you know, what the next thing's going to happen. So there's some interesting and fun applications of that. So one would be music composition. Google has a Project Magenta, which is for generating art and composing music. And so a recurrent neural network is a fully connected network, but then it also has, within, you know, particular layers, it has then time step data. So each layer can then hold some time step data and be trained on that, and then have a memory for that. So so if you apply that to music composition, like the Project Magenta folks did, you could take a whole body of music, like everything, they took everything from Bach to Radiohead, and extracted the melodies, analyzed the melodies, and also the rhythms. And they trained a recurrent neural network, and it's up in the cloud, and I'm gonna show it to you in a minute, and you can use it too, there's a link here, you can use it. So we can train the network to predict the next note. Yes, Dana.
How many lawsuits did that generate?
That's very good. In the case of Bach, I guess that's public domain. I don't know about Radiohead. I hope they never patent protect or copyright protect creep. So very simplistically, if you've trained a neural network, you know, with a body of work, and then you start with a blank page and you want to compose a song, maybe, you know, this is very simplistic, but maybe the probability is that the first note should be a C. So we have a C up there in the upper left. Let's say that you have one C note in your composition. What's the next probability for the highest probability for the next note? Maybe it's a C. And then the next one, maybe it's a G, and maybe it's a G, and then et cetera. And so again, that's very simplistic, but that's the idea, to where some of your hidden layers then have these recurrent neural networks in them, or recurrent layers in them, so that they can store and remember, you know, likelihood, probability likelihoods for given the sequence so far, what the highest probability is for the next thing. Also, when they built this, they also built in some musical rules, you know, so that it wasn't, so that it had some structure, but it's mostly recurrent neural network behind it. So now, here's a little demo. It's called AI Duet. So if you go to that link, you hit play, you get this screen, and you just play around with it a little bit. And so, can you hold the mic? Okay, thanks. All right, so, okay, so I'm gonna play just your normal, rock three chord progression, right? So what it did, that was just one chord, but what it did was it took my input, and then it went to its recurrent neural network and said, okay, I wanna jam with you, and I wanna play something that's not exactly what you played, but in the same vein, right? And so I recognize some of that, and so it's the same vein. So I'll go ahead and play a three chord progression. So I thought, well, you know, it'd be kind of fun to do, you know, if it can do call and answer stuff, maybe it could do rounds, you know, like row, row, row your boat, or Frère Jacques. And so here's a little bit of Frère Jacques. So anyway, and then I thought, well, you know, this whole thing looks a little bit like Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Anybody seen that movie? Right? All right, so let's see. Then we've made communication with the AI aliens, and you know, you just kind of experiment with it, and it tries to jam with you. So that's kind of our current neural.
I like dueling banjos.
I haven't done that.
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe there's been some inbreeding. Okay, so now we're going to dive into unsupervised learning. Unsupervised learning, can somebody tell me what unsupervised learning is? Someone tell me really loudly. Yes, what is unsupervised learning?
Data mining or something. Things we don't know
of. Yes, right. So it's like data mining. It's, you know, give me a bunch of data, feed your model a bunch of data, and have it figure out what's going on. You're not telling it the right answer. So one was, you know, finding clusters. Another one is actually an example from Google Arts and Culture. It's a Google experiment where they took pictures, artworks from hundreds of galleries. They took hundreds of artworks from each of those galleries, and they put them all into a kind of a database, I guess, into a machine learning model. But normally, when you're going to classify artworks, what do? You classify, you know, the type of work it is, you know, maybe who the artist was, and you know what period it was, and is it impressionistic, is it whatever. Well, they didn't do that. They just took the images, and so they used a technique called autoencoding, which is very. So they used convolutional neural networks, you know, for the input, and they got it, and they went through that process, and for each artwork, they came up with I'll just make up a number. Let's say it's a 200 dimensional vector representation. Remember that last layer of the convolutional network? Each artwork has a 200 dimensional vector representation of that particular piece. Well, if you take a vector space, and you know, like a vector space, you could think in terms of, well, even like two dimensions, right? You have vectors, and it's x and y, and you know the vector then is you know the direction of magnitude, but it can be represented with a position in vector space, an x y coordinate in vector space. So it's just like, you know, plotting numbers on a graph for the housing price. It's just a, you know, x, y place in two-dimensional space. So if you had three dimensions, then you could think of that in three dimensions, and it's kind of like this drawing right here, right, where we have x, y, and then we have z, a z dimension. Well, here's this point in space. Well, with two dimensions and three dimensions, in two dimensions, it's just the Pythagorean theorem, right? X, x squared plus y squared is, or x squared plus y squared is the hypotenuse. So that's the distance from this point. You know, that's the length. And then here we've got three dimensions, so it's basically the sum of the squares, the square root of the sum of the squares for all the dimensions, all the three dimensions, and that is its location in vector space. Well, think about 200 dimensions, 300 dimensions, doesn't matter. It's the same formula. You just take the value of each of the real numbers in each of the dimensions of that vector. You add up all of its squares, and then you take the square root of that. So that's its location in, you know, think of that as its location in dimension, in vector space, as far as relative location. So then, if you took these thousands of artworks and came up with that code, right, you did the convolutional network, you came up with that code for each one of those and put them all in vector space, then, and if you could kind of visualize that, which you can't, right? But if you could, you could at least, you can't, but you could calculate the distance from each other, right? Because they're all in this vector space. So we can't visualize it, but what we can do is we can use an unsupervised learning technique called T-SNE, which is a way to do dimensionality reduction so that we can visualize it. And so That's what this is about. So it's a T-SNE map. And so it's taken all this data, which happens to be image data, which then evaluates to these 200 dimension codes, which then have positions in vector space, which then can be visualized in two dimensions, three dimensions, whatever. And that's what we have here. But they weren't cataloged, they weren't tagged. All we know about them is their code. So some human then looked through this map and said, you know, I see some things that look like Japanese wood blocks. And so what they did is they noted the area here and they associated it kind of like you would, you know, coordinates on a map. They said, you know, I see something that looks like Japanese wood blocks here. And so when you click that, it's going to zoom into that area. But that was a human that did that. So we can see things like, for example, a human said, you know, it looks an awful lot like a bunch of ballet dancers in a particular area. So I'm going to click that, and we can see it kind of drill into this map. And because of that algorithm that I just described to you, the convolutional network, doing the auto-encoding down to that code, and then hanging them all into vector space, how I just described, then all of these similar-looking pictures ended up together. You know? And so there's some others. Here's, I haven't even looked at this one. Lost in Space, I don't know what this is. Those happen to be probably, those are artworks that look much like each other. And then maybe one more, religious woodcuts. So those appear to be a lot like each other. But anyway, that was the technique. Okay. So another unsupervised learning win, you know, success story lately has been something called Word2Vec. And what that does is that uses a similar technique of using vectors and vector space, but it uses techniques like what's called continuous bag of words, and some other another technique that basically will comb through documents and look at maybe five words that are occurring together. Maybe of those five words, it looks at the middle word, and then tries to kind of ascertain the probability that that word is going to be used in the context of those other four words. And so it does that for a whole body of work like Shakespeare or whatever. And then it can then put those words into vector space like we're doing here. And so what it does then is maybe you have a word king and queen and woman and princess. And then it will then come up with dimensions. Now you don't tell it the dimensions. What it does, though, is the algorithm figures out some dimensions. And so, as an example, you might have one dimension that's royalty, one dimension. It may have figured out that another dimension is masculinity, femininity, age, whatever, and then is assigning real numbers to each of those dimensions in the vector. It then hangs them in vector space, and then something very interesting happens. The vector offsets then between those word vectors and vector space, then, for example, exhibit characteristics like the same vector offset from man to woman, in vector offset in dimension, in direction as well as magnitude would be, man to woman would be the same as uncle to aunt and king to queen. And then also you can do plurals. You know, they've noticed that it's pulling out plurals like king is to kings as queen is to queens. And then even you can do vector arithmetic. So you could do if king is here, man is here, queen is here, woman is here in n-dimensional vector space. You know, this is very simple. then you could start to do, you know, like king minus man plus woman equals queen. And so very interesting relationships. And so you could do that for natural language processing. And then the TensorFlow embedded projector has a visualization for that as well. Like, if, for example, give me some word, some common noun. Anyone, just shout out. This will be like a Java. Word association. What?
Java?
Java, okay, yeah. Such a geek. Okay, so here's Java. And so let's say that we want just maybe 36 points near Java. We'll isolate those. And this is using something called PCA. So not only is the Word-to-Vec an unsupervised learning technique, but then also PCA, which is principal component analysis, is another technique for being able to do dimensionality reduction. You know, these word vectors are you know, many vectors. Each one is, many dimensions in the vectors. And so here then are the related words. So there are some programming words. I wouldn't be surprised if there are, I guess there aren't any like geographic words like Java, the island, but so Perl, window, virtual, etc. And then this is based upon cosine distance, angular distance in the vector space. And then here's Euclidean distance, which is what I was talking about, the Pythagorean theorem and kind of extending that. That's Euclidean distance. And so here are the nearest points in the original space and their Euclidean distance, the relative Euclidean distance. And then here's the kind of the reduced dimension representation of that. Okay. So now we'll dive into, with the remaining time that we have left, so it's supposed to go down 9. If I could beg another like 10 minutes, if I could go to 10 after 9, I would appreciate that. Don't feel bad about walking out in the middle of it, but it'll take me just a little bit of time to get through this. So reinforcement learning, in a nutshell, is you've got an agent, and then you want it to learn to do something, perform some task. And you reinforce the learning, just like you were gonna, you know, give a horse a carrot or something like that, when it does something right. So one of the classic cases, kind of the test beds for reinforcement learning, is grid world. So it's just a matrix of like chessboard or whatever, where you've got cells, and then here we've got walls. Here we've got, you could think of this as a mouse, and this is the cheese. You know, this is the agent, and it's supposed to get here. And it knows nothing about the world. The agent knows nothing about the world. But here are the rules of grid world. The agent is allowed to move left, right, up or down. Those are the actions it can take. And it can be in different states. The different states are what cell it's in. And then it's rewarded 0 points for each move. And then it's rewarded 5 points for reaching the top right corner. That's also called the terminal state. So some of the rules are the agent can't move into a wall or off the grid. And the agent doesn't have a model of the grid world. So it's got to discover things as it interacts. One of the challenges, if you think about that for a bit, one of the challenges is if it's only rewarded when it gets here, how in the world can it assign credit for something it did way back here? You know, and so that's one of the challenges. That's called the credit assignment problem. And so to model this, you know, what the states are and what the actions are, you can use what's called a Markov decision process. And that's just a fancy name for this kind of a model of that world, where you've got states. Like here the state is, I'm in cell 00, and if I take a left, if I go left, I'm gonna end up in that same state because I can't go into the wall or can't go off the grid. And these are all self-explanatory. And then a bunch of other cells. And then here we have the terminal state. If I enter the terminal state, the action in, that caused me to enter the terminal state then gives me 5 points. So here's one action, there's an action. And then if I'm in the terminal state and I try to move, I'm just gonna end up back in the terminal state. And all actions are deterministic. So if I, as an agent, say I wanna move up, then it's gonna move up. In some models, you can make it so that it's stochastic, to where it's, you know, it's, there's a probability. If I say I wanna go up, maybe there's a 90% probability that I will go up, and then there's a 10% probability that I'll go somewhere else because, you know, the environment is stochastic. So here's kind of a model of what's going on. You've got the agent and you've got the environment. So the agent, based upon its state and any rewards that it's gotten, then makes an action. So the state might be 0, 0, and the action might be I want to go up. The environment then takes the action and then calculates what the new state is and what reward the agent should get. And that's called SARS, state, action, reward, state, action, reward, SAR, you know, until it gets done. So there's this Java application, this Java open source project called Burlap, which is an Apache project actually, that that has a reinforcement learning library, and it's located here in GitHub, and I'm gonna use that now to show you these training episodes. So here is the Burlap examples, and we're going to use, we're gonna show the grid world. So I'll run this, and we'll see at the bottom where we'll see that there were 49 episodes down at the bottom. It's a little bit hard to see in a second. So you see 49 episodes here, and these are the number of moves that it took to reach the terminal state. And notice as we get more and more episodes, it learned to do it more quickly, to where it got down to 31 moves. So then here is the map, the actual visualization of what's going on here. So for the first episode, we see that there's this many moves. And so if I went to that first move and then I hit the down arrow to kind of go through the moves, you'll notice that it just kind of randomly wanders around, has no clue this first time about anything. It's never received a reward, so if it ever gets to the reward, you know, it's just by pure luck. And it will eventually, because, you know, if an infinite number of monkeys, you know, typed on an infinite number of typewriters for an infinite number of years, then eventually it's going to write the works of Shakespeare, right? So eventually it'll get there, and lo and behold, you know, toward the end, it finally gets there, but it doesn't know what to do in that upper right-hand quadrant either, right? It's never tasted that reward. And then finally, you know, someday it gets there, like here. There we go. Okay, finally got there. So now, let's fast forward to maybe episode 25. And we'll see that it's doing much better. Now notice it still probably does some wandering around the lower left-hand coordinate, or quadrant. But once it gets kind of close, in the right quadrant anyway, we should see it kind of zoom right to it. Okay? Now why does it do that? So that's a clue as to the algorithm that's being used in this model. And so we can see at the end here that it goes directly to it. But why did it amass more knowledge of what's going on up here? And so that has to do with the algorithm. It's called a Q learning algorithm. And essentially what happens is as it tastes the reward, as it gets points for being up in the upper right-hand corner at the terminal position, it assigns a value to being in there, in that position. It's like, for example, here, it has correctly ascertained, since it's been there, it's correctly ascertained that if it's in this position, it's worth 5 points because it can make a move to the right and get 5 points. Same thing with being here and moving up, it's gonna get 5 points. Here, it says 4.5 points, or yeah, 4.5 points, and that's due to something that I'll tell you in a very little bit here. Now notice that some of these aren't filled in yet. Like we've got some red squares that are zeros, and that's because it hasn't had enough experience with those cells to be able to tell what it's worth to be in that cell. And so it's also worked out a policy. So if it can know, it can try to ascertain what it's worth to be in a cell, and also what it's worth to take an optimal action, and for the rest of the time. So here, for example, it's worth 3.65 points to be in this cell, and then to take the optimal action. These arrows are what the optimal action has been. So that's its policy. Now the reason why we see this number decrease is that we've got something called future discounted rewards. And so what that is that takes and applies a percentage to kind of disregard or to put less weight on the ultimate, like on the next move, and kind of discount future rewards. So we say 0.9, use a discount of 0.9. And so so discount the future reward, but put more importance on more short-term rewards. And so it's kind of the analogy is, you know, you have some people that are so focused on the future that they're not really making wise decisions, you know, in the here and now. And then you've got other people that are doing the exact opposite. So that's the way the future discounted rewards work. So this particular example uses a discount factor of 0.9. And that's why we see the numbers decrease. If we didn't use a discount factor, then once it's found an optimal policy to get through, you would see them all being fives. And so there's another related concept called exploration versus exploitation. So when the agent is trying to figure out its way through, you know, the optimal path to get to the reward, the terminal state, one tack that it can take is to always make the decision, always choose what has worked best in the past. So if I've found out that I've gotten points for taking a particular path, then, you know, I could just, you know, why not just always take that on the next episode? Well, the one reason why is there may be better paths to take. There may be better, we haven't gone into every cell, so we don't know whether there are better paths to take. So exploration is exploring those better paths maybe, or other paths that may be better, versus exploitation, which is taking the greedy known paths. It's kind of like going into a casino. You have five slot machines, and you're having really good luck on one slot machine, but maybe the next one is better, you know, and so you could either stay with that one or go with the other one, same deal. And so when you're tuning a reinforcement learning problem environment, when you're tuning the agent, you could tell the agent, hey, do 80% exploitation, but do 20% exploration so that you can see whether there's any better things. So in a nutshell, then, the reason why we saw that after a few episodes that the agent got smarter in the upper right quadrant toward the terminal position was that as it is getting these rewards, as it's getting that reward, it's then attributing that to the cells around it. So a particular state, it attributes the actions taken from that state, and then assessing what values it got, and then it's recording it in this, what's called a Q learning table. So these are the states, these are the actions, these are the values that it got. And so as it's recording it, it's filling in this table with where all the states are, which is maps to all the cells. And so then as it's making actions and getting rewards in the future, then we see then in the...
Since the agent actually doesn't know where the final state is or terminal state is, and there's no rewarding in HA, we will accept the terminal state. Like, I think it was getting 5 points awarded, or everything zero. So in that case, when it finds it at some point randomly, their first time, it has to maintain huge state machine to record all this movements, I guess, right?
This is what this is.
It has to be extremely big, I guess.
Right, so as the, I'll repeat the question then, or the assertion that since it only gets the reward at the end, then it has to maintain this huge table of the states and the rewards based upon the actions. You called it a state machine. It's very much like a state machine. Yes, and so it's a recording, and kind of using then a formula to called the Bellman equation, if you're familiar with that, where it then can not only record the points that it can attribute to that particular state, but then it can also, as it builds up these rewards, then it can attribute it as it gets farther and farther away from the goal. And so that's why we see these numbers higher and this path more defined. Once it gets here, it just goes right to it. But then here, you know, the more it plays, the more episodes it gets, the more that table gets filled in toward the start. So that's in a nutshell. And so then I decided to just kind of to reinforce that I had learned about reinforcement learning. I created a tic-tac-toe application that could learn how to play tic-tac-toe or learn how to win a tic-tac-toe using reinforcement learning, using this burlap application. And it was inspired by Richard, this reinforcement learning and introduction, which is kind of the reference text for reinforcement learning. And there is a 2016 version of it, these people kind of wrote the book on reinforcement learning. So the learning agent and environment is, you've got an agent, which I'm using as the X player. The action can be a move, you know, it can be a, you know, what cell am I playing in? And then the environment then is O. Not only does the environment, take the action in, and then send out the new state and give a reward to the agent, but it also plays the O position. And so you've got this situation where you have a two-player game. The computer, the reinforcement learning environment, is actually playing the O position. So the way I've got the O playing is that if it can win, you know, if there's a way that the O, I've, you know, programmed this in to where if the O can win by completing a three in a row, then it'll do it. Otherwise, if it can block the X, you know, from getting three in a row, then it'll do it. And otherwise, if it can play a corner or a center, it'll do it. So it's very kind of rudimentary playing, and it plays second. The agent plays first, and so that's the idea. And then here's the Q learning table. All the states are basically the possible positions of the game, the possible states of the game, and then we have the actions. Some of them are NA because you know, you can't play in cell five in this particular state because cell five is taken. But then on the ones where there's a possible action then, it's building up these Q values, right? So anyway, here I'll go ahead and run this then as the last thing. I'll go to the Java application. And this is open source too, by the way. You can, I've got the GitHub in the presentation slides. So we'll go ahead and play this. And notice in the output, I'm going to zoom this for you. You'll notice in the output that in the beginning, the little zero means zero, it means 01. The dot means it was a cat's game. And then the X means the X1, the agent. And so you'll notice that more and more, the X is winning. Sometimes the O wins. So if I look at the visualization, so the first game, let's see who won. Actually, X may have won the first game, or may, I don't know. But we'll see who wins. So here's the first move. X moves there. O moves there, because it wants a corner. X moves there, O moves there, and then X, by just luck, because it doesn't know how to play the game yet, and it doesn't know the rules, right? It's just gonna react based upon its rewards. And so then X moves there, O moves there, and it's a cat's game. But then going down later, much later, actually, there's, you know, thousands of episodes here. But I'll just cut to the chase here. I don't know, did it win the last? I don't think it won the last one, but it won the second to the last one. So we'll go to that one. And we see then, at the second to the last one, that X plays there. X plays there. Oh, and 0-1. I don't have this calculated right. Let's see. Right, so looking through this game, X plays there, O plays there, and then X has worked out in these thousands of iterations because of the reinforcement learning and the Q table and all that, that the best move for this combination, the one where it gets the most points, is there, and then it does the three in a row. So then the last slide is just what a self-driving car sees, the self-driving Tesla, and as you probably know, if you all the Tesla owners. As they're driving, they're actually training the next generation of Teslas because, you know, they all have cameras, rear mounting, side mounting, whatever, and all these sensors that then are sensing the way the driver reacts. So as the driver's making decisions and small corrections and, you know, brakes and things like that, then it's machine learning algorithms are being, that are in the cloud are being updated. But this is what a Tesla sees, like the different cameras and what it's finding as far as pedestrians, stoplights, things like that. And then this is sped up. It's not actually going this fast. I'd be scared to death if I were that that person behind the wheel. But anyway, it's all, you know, kind of machine learning. So I appreciate your attentiveness and letting me take you a little bit later than we said. Thank you for your attention.